Next important topic is bacterial cell structure or anatomy. Okay, and it's extremely important, you know, even from the point of view of clinical vignettes, because in a lot of clinical vignettes on infectious diseases, you will encounter terms like pili, you know, fimbriae, flagella, capsule. So all these are, you know, ABCs or the basic foundations of, you know, bacterial structures, which are going to help you a lot in solving clinical vignettes on infectious diseases. So this is a very, very important topic. And we're going to understand bacterial cell structure or anatomy as differences between two very important categories of bacteria based on gram stain, that is gram positive organisms and gram negative organisms. Okay. So we are going to draw two boxes like this, G plus, G minus. So the left one is gram positive bacterium, the right one is gram negative bacterium. We are going to dissect the structure of bacteria from inside to outside, all right? And initially, we are going to see what is common between gram positive and gram negative, and then we'll see the differences. So as I said, we are going to go from inside to outside. So the innermost thing is nothing in the cell is nothing but the cytoplasm, and the cytoplasm is surrounded by what? This is the cytoplasm is surrounded by the layer of cell membrane, also known as plasma membrane, also known as inner membrane. So this is the innermost layer surrounding the cytoplasm. So guys, now few important points about cell membrane. Remember, it is 5 to 10 nanometers thick. It has got respiratory enzymes, all right? And it has got the property of being semi-permeable. In other words, selectively permeable. Okay. Now, what is meant by these terms, semi-permeable or selectively permeable? Now, what you can see over here? You can see this is a guard or a policeman. Okay, this is a guard. Okay, another analogy which we can take over here is that of a policeman. Okay, so the job of a guard or a policeman is to prevent the, you know, entry of intruders. Okay, and what you can see over here, this is nothing but cell membrane. Now remember, cell membrane is nothing but a phospholipid bilayer with the lipid part inside and the phosphate part outside. All right. Now why it is called as selectively permeable or semi-permeable? The reason is, just like a sincere guard or a watchman or a policeman allows the entry of only those people who have got the, you know, valid ID proof or who are authorized to enter a building or a designated area, they are not going to permit just anyone and everyone to pass through. Similarly, a cell membrane also has got a very, you know, very important job to do. That is to allow the entry of only selected molecules in terms of solutes or amino acids or nutrients, etc. to enter the cell, and not anything and everything. Okay. So who is this? So this fellow is talking to the cell membrane. Hi, I'm a nutrient. Can I come in? The cell membrane obviously will be welcoming to the entry of this organism, of this, you know, nutrient. So the cell membrane will respond, yes, come in, of course. Then we've got another agent, as you can see in purple. Hi, I'm an antibiotic. Can I come in, please? Don't you dare come in. Okay. So, you know, it's not that no antibiotics can penetrate through the cell membrane. This is just an example over here I have taken to emphasize upon the fact that not everything and anything can cross the cell membrane and gain access, you know, inside the cell. So that is what is meant by semi-permeable or selectively permeable. And it is nothing but as I've mentioned, it's a phospholipid bilayer. Phospholipid bilayer. Okay. So cell membrane is present in all living cells, and bacterial cells are not exceptions. All right. So now let me, you know, come back to these two green squares, and let me modify the diagram a little bit. Now, what modification I'm going to do? Now, what have I done, guys? I have drawn some invaginations of the cell membrane. So what are these? These are invaginations of cell membrane, and these invaginations are referred to as mesosomes or chondroids. Okay, now guys, there's a reason why I have shown these vaginations as a little longer in G plus bacterium, whereas not so long in G minus, because I want all of you to remember that mesosomes are more prominent in gram positive bacteria. Remember P for prominent and P for positive. Okay, so these are more prominent in gram positive bacteria. Now, since these are nothing but invaginations of cell membrane, and cell membrane, as I mentioned, has got respiratory enzymes. So what are the functions of mesosomes? One of course is respiration, and the other one is cell division. There's a famous MCQ asked about mesosomes, not a new MCQ, very old MCQ rather. Are these essential for life of a bacterium or not? Absolutely yes, guys. Mesosomes, being nothing but invaginations of the cell membrane, are absolutely essential for life of a bacterium. So they are essential for life of a bacterium. All right. So this is about the cell membrane and its invagination, that is mesosomes or chondroids. Let me give a little more attention to G minus bacteria. Okay, so this is a G minus bacterium. All right. Now, the innermost layer surrounding the cytoplasm is nothing but the cell membrane or the plasma membrane, also known as the inner membrane. Okay, so if there is something known as inner membrane, there should be something called as outer membrane also. And yes, it does exist. The outer membrane is a structure which is present in gram-negative organisms, the gram-negative bacteria, which I have drawn over here as in pink color. So this is nothing but the outer membrane, and this green one of course is the inner or the cell membrane or the plasma membrane. Few words about the outer membrane. The outer membrane also is a phospholipid bilayer, just like the inner membrane, but it is a little different from the inner membrane. In what sense? It has some additional structures called as porins, which are a kind of proteins. Remember P for porins, P for proteins, and a very important structure called as endotoxin, which we'll discuss in detail in a few minutes. Okay, so remember, this again is a common question: porins are present in which kind of bacteria, gram positive or gram negative? Answer is gram negative, because where are porins located? In the outer membrane. Is outer membrane present in gram positive? No. Outer membrane is a part and parcel of the property of gram negative organisms. Okay, so it's a phospholipid bilayer, and it has got these additional structures called as porins and endotoxin. And this space between the two membranes, the inner and the outer membrane, This space is known as the periplasmic space. Okay, periplasmic space. And this periplasmic space, because it is a space, so it is going to lodge something in it. What is that something? This spiral thing which I am drawing over here, it is nothing but very thin peptidoglycan. So this spiral thing is, this is very thin peptidoglycan. Peptidoglycan, guys, I have mentioned before, the name of the cell wall constituent of bacterial cell wall. Okay, so this is peptidoglycan. Very thin layer is there in the periplasmic space. And what else is located in this periplasmic space? These golden circles which I am drawing, what are these? These are nothing but beta lactamases. In pharmacology, you are going to read about different kinds or categories of antimicrobial agents. One of them are beta-lactams, and there are certain bacteria which produce beta-lactamases, meaning these are the enzymes which will break down the antibiotics called as beta-lactams. So these organisms, when they infect an individual and that individual is taking beta-lactams, the patient won't respond to these beta-lactams by virtue of the beta-lactamases being produced by these bacteria. Okay, so remember, in gram-negative organisms, beta-lactamases are located in the periplasmic space. Okay, but also remember that beta-lactamases are not present in all gram-negative organisms. Okay, only in some of them. Okay, so this is about something, the extra edge about the gram-negative structure. Now, let us come back to gram-positive structure. Let us see where its peptidoglycan is located. Now, gram-positive bacteria do not have the outer membrane, and they have got what? And they have got very, very thick layer of peptidoglycan. Okay? So, this is very thick peptidoglycan. And even some gram-positive organisms can produce beta-lactamase, but since periplasmic space is not there in gram-positive organisms, these beta-lactamases are, you know, they are produced and thrown out into the surroundings of the gram-positive bacteria. Okay, so these golden molecules are nothing but beta-lactamases, which are actively thrown out or secreted, in the local area around the gram-positive bacteria. So these are nothing but beta-lactamases, which are secreted out. Now, there is a term called as cell envelope. Now, it refers to what? It refers to all the layers surrounding the bacterial cytoplasm. Okay? Right from the inner membrane or the cell membrane to peptidoglycan, whether it is thin in G minus or it is very thick in G plus, and also the outer membrane which is there in G minus and absent in G plus. Okay, so cell envelope is, you know, whatever layers are present around the cytoplasm in a bacterial cell. Okay, so we have seen the basic structure of G plus and G minus. So cell envelope, as we have seen, is thicker in G plus bacteria. As I mentioned, there's a very thick layer of peptidoglycan in G plus bacteria. Whereas, if somebody asks you, cell envelope is, you know, more complicated in which kind of bacteria, G plus or G minus, your answer is going to be G minus. Because as you can see, the G minus bacteria have got the inner membrane, then the periplasmic space lodging, the beta-lactamases and the thin PG, that is peptidoglycan layer, and the outer membrane also is present, which in turn has got additional structures called as porins and endotoxin. So, cell envelope is more complicated in structure, is more complicated in G minus bacteria, thicker in G plus, more complicated in G minus bacteria. And if I ask you, which kind of bacterial infections are, you know, tougher or more difficult to treat, G plus or G minus? Which kind of bacterial infections are more difficult to treat? At the outset, you might think that because the cell envelope is thicker in G plus, they should be more, these infections should be more difficult to treat, but it's not like that. The correct answer to this question is what? The correct answer is G minus bacteria. You know why, guys? Because G minus bacteria have got two lipid bilayers in the form of the cell membrane and the outer membrane, both of which are phospholipid bilayers. And I've explained in detail how the sincere guard or policeman or watchman, works to prevent the entry of, you know, unwanted, things, unwanted people inside a building or an area, okay? And very similarly, these phospholipid bilayer membranes also act, okay? So, gram-negative bacterial infections are tougher to treat because the lipid bilayers which are 2 in number in gram negative organisms, these lipid bilayers act as barriers to the entry of molecules, including antibiotics. That is why, as a general rule, we say that gram-negative bacterial infections are more difficult or tougher to treat as compared to gram-positive infections. All right? So, next we have, now let us dissect gram-negative bacterial cells a little more and focus on the outer membrane. Okay? So, the green box is nothing but the, it represents the cell membrane, and the outer pink box represents the outer membrane. So, in the outer membrane, as I've already mentioned, we have got what? It's a phospholipid bilayer. It has got proteins called as porins and LPS, that is endotoxin. Okay. So, I've previously used the term endotoxin in the diagram, and now I'm going to introduce a synonym word for endotoxin, that is LPS or lipopolysaccharide. Okay, so this whole thing is referred to as endotoxin or lipopolysaccharide or LPS. Okay, so as the name LPS implies, it's made up of lipid part and the polysaccharide part. So, this part which is embedded in the outer membrane, this is the lipid part, and this very part which is protruding or projecting out of the cell, which I've drawn in golden color, this is nothing but the polysaccharide part. Okay, polysaccharide part. Okay, now, structurally, LPS has got lipid and polysaccharide, and why it is called as endotoxin? Because this causes what is known as endotoxic shock, also referred to as gram-negative shock. Now, guys, before I explain what exactly this means, we need to, know the structure of LPS or endotoxin. So, this is the structure of endotoxin or lipopolysaccharide, LPS. Okay. Now, as you can see, it has got, 3 important parts, the lipid part and the core polysaccharide and the outer polysaccharide. So, as far as the lipid part is concerned, the lipid part has got what is known as lipid A. Okay, lipid A. Now, remember, lipid A has got capital A in its name. So, remember, it is the A1 or the number one toxic moiety. I just mentioned that LPS is responsible for a very, fatal, deadly disease, that is endotoxic shock or gram-negative shock. And question is often asked, what exact part of LPS is responsible for the endotoxic shock? The answer is lipid A. So, it is the A1 toxic moiety or the villain which is responsible for the disease gram-negative shock or endotoxic shock. Okay. So, as we see over here, the lipid A part has got, disaccharide, diphosphate part to it. You can see these two phosphate molecules. Okay. And these are the, this whole thing represents the disaccharide, and you can see certain fatty acids, dangling like this. Okay. Now, a very important example of a fatty acid which is part of the lipid A is, remember, beta hydroxy myristic acid. You will never ever come across this term anywhere else except for here, that is LPS. Okay, now, so this is number one. The second part, as I said, is the core polysaccharide, and the third part is the outer polysaccharide. Okay, this is the outer polysaccharide. It is also, the outer polysaccharide is also referred to as the somatic antigen or the O antigen. Remember, guys, it is not zero antigen, it is the O antigen. Okay, outer polysaccharide. O actually stands for outer. Okay, now the core polysaccharide is made up of 3 to 5 sugars, and the outer polysaccharide is made up of 25 repeating units of 3 to 5 sugars. Okay. Now, imagine if we talk about the outer polysaccharide, the three sugars, if I, you know, represent in three different colors, one is pink, then we have got green sugar, and we have got golden sugar. Okay. So, this is one unit. Say, this is one unit made up of three sugars, and there could be 20 up to 25 repeating such units. Okay. In the outer polysaccharide, for instance, the unit pink, green and golden is repeated like this. Okay. So, this is one unit, this is second unit. So, it is a polysaccharide. This is the outer polysaccharide. Okay. Whereas the core polysaccharide is made up of limited number of sugars. Okay. And the outer polysaccharide, outer PS, that is outer polysaccharide, it varies a lot. It varies a lot amongst different bacteria, and therefore it is used for what is known as serotyping. This is extremely important. Okay, now what do we understand by serotyping? I'll just give you a simple example. Now guys, remember, in microbiology, typing means classification. Classification. Okay, who are we classifying? What are we classifying? We are classifying microorganisms. All right. And as we all know, the bacteria have got a lot of important structures, like, you know, different kinds of proteins, sugars and all. Okay. And one such example of an important structure is the outer polysaccharide. Okay. And I've mentioned that it is going to be variable in different bacteria. So if we study the outer polysaccharide in different bacteria, then we can classify bacteria accordingly. Okay. So sero means what over here? Sero means actually surface. So serotyping means typing or classifying bacteria based on, you know, certain surface structures. One such example of a surface structure is nothing but the outer polysaccharide. All right. We are going to see in bacteriology a lot of examples of serotyping. Basically, serotyping is done to classify a bacterium below the level of the species. For example, the best example which we can quote over here is, let's say, if you are talking about outer polysaccharide, which is there only in gram negative organisms, we have got Salmonella typhi, okay, which has got more than 200 serotypes, okay, based on the O antigen or the outer polysaccharide. All right. What does this mean? The name of the genus is Salmonella. The species name is typhi. But if suppose there are, 200 different Salmonella typhi organisms, then each one of them is going to have a unique type of O antigen or the outer polysaccharide. Okay. So we can designate these 200 different types of O antigens as O12, O200. Okay. So that is why, I was referring to classifying an organism below the level of the species. So the common thing between the 200 bacteria whom we are calling S. typhi is, the common thing is, all of them belong to the genus Salmonella and all of them belong to the species typhi. But still, all those 200 organisms are different from each other because each one of them has got its own unique variety or type of the O antigen. So what we have done, we have classified S. typhi into different serotypes based on the surface antigen called as O antigen. Okay. So this is just one example of, serotyping using, keeping what in consideration? The structure of the O antigen. Okay. So remember, this is really important, the somatic antigen or the O antigen. All right. And the lipid A part is the toxic part. Now, what is meant by gram-negative shock or endotoxic shock? It's a highly fatal disease which is caused by lipopolysaccharide or endotoxin. Now, LPS is called as endotoxin because it's a you know toxic or you know toxic substance, toxic to humans, and it is embedded, it is present inside the structure of the gram negative organisms, specifically where it is located in the outer membrane. Okay, and the lipid A part which is responsible for the toxic shock is similar in structure in all G minus bacteria. Okay, so the lipid A part, which is the toxic moiety or the toxic part, is similar in structure in all the gram negative bacteria. That is why we use a blanket term called as endotoxic shock or the gram negative shock. You will never ever hear of you know terms like Klebsiella gram negative shock or Escherichia coli gram negative shock. Klebsiella and Escherichia coli both are gram negative organisms, okay, but we don't use their specific names to represent the endotoxic shock you know caused by a specific gram negative organism, because the villain or the culprit is lipid A, which is similar in structure in all gram negative organisms. Okay, so do remember, lipid A is the toxic part. Okay, now I'll draw a schematic diagram. Lipid A is the villain, so let me use the red or the color of danger. This is the lipid A. Okay, now there is a bridge which attaches the lipid A to the, this suppose is the core polysaccharide, and then we have got the longest one, this is the outer polysaccharide, outer PS. Now this bridge which is connecting the lipid A with the core polysaccharide, this bridge is referred to as keto deoxy octiolinic acid, that is KDO, KDO, that is keto deoxy octiolinic acid. Okay, this again is unique to only LPS. Now guys, as I mentioned that LPS is or endotoxin is present in the outer membrane of gram negative organisms. Now there's an exception to this important fact. What is that exception? There's one gram positive organism which despite being gram positive has got endotoxin in its structure. And what is its name? Remember, we already have discussed gram stain, and gram positive organisms appear positively blue on gram stain. So I'm going to write the name of that special bacterium in blue color because it's gram positive. That special bacterium is Listeria monocytogenes. Okay, this is the only G plus bacterium having endotoxin in its structure. Okay, endotoxin is an integral part of the structure of gram negative bacteria, so it is expected to be you know released out of the bacterial body only when the bacteria die, only when they die and they undergo lysis. Okay, so endotoxin, remember, is released on the death of gram negative bacteria, except one important gram negative organism which produces endotoxin even while it is alive, and that is responsible for the you know fatality or the seriousness of the disease caused by these gram negative organisms. So who are those special fellows? Because they are gram negative, let me use the red color for these organisms, Neisseria. Now Neisseria are what? These are gram negative diplococci. Diplococci meaning these cocci are arranged in pairs or groups of two. Okay, so Neisseria are gram negative diplococci which release endotoxin even while they are alive, that is during life. Okay, so this is one exception, and there is one more exception pertaining to Neisseria. In case of Neisseria, the endotoxin is called as not lipopolysaccharide but lipooligosaccharide. lipo-oligosaccharide, that is LOS, because the outer polysaccharide actually has got, less number of sugars, so it is not very long. So that is why it is referred to as LOS, that is lipo-oligosaccharide. Now, let us see how exactly the endotoxin or the lipopolysaccharide causes endotoxic shock and what are the features of this particular disease. Now, guys, endotoxin, especially the lipid A, as I mentioned, remember, lipid A should remind you of the fact that, it is the A1 or the number one toxic moiety as far as endotoxin is concerned, okay? So, it is the lipid A which is going to, which is going to cause all the problems to the patients. So, remember, the lipid A part of the endotoxin is going to activate macrophages, complement and tissue factor. So, remember it as M, C and T. Okay. Now, what will happen as a result of activation of macrophages? There will be production of important molecules like interleukin-1, TNF, that is tumor necrosis factor, and nitric oxide. Now, remember these as I, T and N. Remember I, T, N. Remember the I-10 car. I for interleukin-1, which is going to be responsible for fever, okay? TNF is tumor necrosis factor. It is going to be responsible for fever and hypotension. And nitric oxide is going to cause hypotension, okay? So, remember, in the middle, we have got the tumor necrosis factor, which is going to produce two effects, okay? Fever and hypotension. And on either side of T, we have got I and N. I stands for interleukin-1, which is going to cause fever, and N stands for nitric oxide, which is going to cause hypotension, and both are going to be caused by TNF, tumor necrosis factor, in the middle. And then we have got complement. It will also activate complement. Complement is basically a group of proteins belonging to the innate immune system, which comes to our rescue when certain infection happens. Okay, more details about all these facts: the complement system, macrophages, interleukin-1, how exactly it is produced, how what exact role it plays in the immune response. All that we are going to discuss in immunology. Okay, for now just remember the schematic representation. The activation of complement as a result of action of endotoxin is going to lead to the production of two important complement proteins called as C3A and C5A. Okay, now C3A, guys, is responsible for recruitment of neutrophils. Okay, wherever C5A concentration is going to be more in the tissues, neutrophils will literally smell that heightened concentration of C5A and they will be attracted towards that area of increased C5A. So that is referred to as neutrophil chemotaxis. Okay, and C3A is another complement protein produced as a result of complement activation. It is going to cause hypotension and edema in the patient. Okay, and then lastly, we have got T stands for tissue factor. The lipid A part of endotoxin is also going to activate tissue factor, which in turn will activate the coagulation cascade, and the patient will land up in DIC, that is disseminated intravascular coagulation. DIC stands for disseminated intravascular coagulation. This is a very important entity which will be taught to you very nicely and in detail in pathology. Okay, so remember DIC. So this is how the endotoxin is going to trouble the patient. Now, the other thing about endotoxin or LPS which I want all of you to remember is, now remember, when we talk about LPS or endotoxin, we have got L and the PS part. The lipid part is toxic, but it is non-immunogenic. In other words, it is non-antigenic. Now, what is meant by being non-immunogenic or non-antigenic? Remember, genic means to produce. Immunogenic means a generation or production of immune response. Antigenic and immunogenic are synonymous terms. Our immune system will be, will get up and do some work in the form of production of antibodies or activation of some immunologically competent cells whenever there is invasion in the body, whenever some foreign substance or foreign organism invades the body. Okay, so LPS we are saying is the toxic part. Obviously, we would want our immune system to step up and, you know, help us by producing some antibodies or some other, you know, immunologically active structure against it. But sadly, the lipid part, non-immunogenic or non-antigenic, which is a bad news for us because against the lipid part, the, you know, we won't be able to produce antibodies. On the other hand, if we talk about the polysaccharide part, okay, over here we are referring to what? We are referring to the outer polysaccharide, okay? This is the, remember, outer polysaccharide. L is the lipid part and the outer polysaccharide. If we talk about the outer polysaccharide is non-toxic, unlike LPS, meaning it is not going to be responsible for, you know, disease. But it is immunogenic or antigenic. Immunogenic or antigenic. Okay. Now, but these antibodies which are going to be produced against the outer polysaccharide are not going to be of, you know, any help to us as far as, you know, protection against the endotoxic shock is concerned. But because the outer polysaccharide is antigenic or immunogenic, so the immune system is going to produce antibodies against the outer polysaccharide. Analysis of these antibodies in the serum of the patient will help us find out what exact serotype has infected the patient. Okay, so because of the property of being immunogenic or antigenic, the outer polysaccharide therefore is used for epidemiological purpose. Epidemiological purpose or studies, meaning in an area we can find out, you know, how many people residing in a particular area are infected with, say, a particular serotype of a particular kind of microorganism. Okay, so that is the significance of knowing the fact that outer polysaccharide is immunogenic or antigenic. Now, the next important structure in the bacterial cell anatomy are structures called as adhesins. Now, what are these? These are the structures which help the bacteria to attach to the host cells. Now, this attachment to the host cells is a very crucial step in the initiation of infection in a lot of organisms. Okay, so as far as, you know, bacteria are concerned, these adhesins can be categorized into two divisions or categories. G plus bacteria have got adhesins known as teichoic acids, and G minus bacteria have got what are known as fimbriae or pili. Singular is pilus, plural is pili. Okay, now teichoic acids are what? These are nothing but polymers of ribitol phosphate or glycerol phosphate. So, teichoic acids, structurally, they are polymers of ribitol phosphate or glycerol phosphate, and they arise from the cell wall of the gram-positive bacteria. Okay. Now, in some bacteria, what happens? In some G plus bacteria, the glycerol phosphate part, if suppose, you know, the teichoic acid is a polymer of glycerol phosphate, and this glycerol phosphate, which is making up the teichoic acid, in certain bacteria, this glycerol phosphate might arise. It might arise. Remember, not always, but sometimes. So it might arise from the lipid part of the bacterial cell membrane instead of arising from the cell wall. Okay, so we have got this G plus bacterium. All right, I told you that it has got a very, you know, thick peptidoglycan, which I am depicting over here in the gray color. So from the cell wall, these adhesins arise. All right, so this is referred to as teichoic acid. As you can see, this blue structure is arising from the gray structure. The gray structure represents the bacterial cell wall.
But in certain G plus bacteria, where the teichoic acid is made up of glycerol phosphate, in some of these bacteria, what has been observed is the glycerol phosphate teichoic acid arises from the lipid part of the bacterial cell membrane. For the sake of simplicity of the diagram, I'm not drawing the phospholipid bilayer structure of the cell membrane. I have simply drawn a box, okay? So this dark blue thing is what? This dark blue thing is referred to as lipoteichoic acid. So basically, lipoteichoic acid is that kind of teichoic acid which is arising from the lipid part of the cell membrane. Remember, cell membrane is nothing but phospholipid bilayer, okay? And this, you know, this emanation or arising from the lipid part, you know, in case of teichoic acid, this has been observed with those kind of teichoic acids which are made up of glycerol phosphate and not ribitol phosphate. And then again, not all the glycerol phosphates are going to arise from the lipid part of the cell membrane. There are also certain G plus bacteria where the glycerol phosphate arises from the cell wall part only, okay? So, an easy way to remember is, so in G+, the glycerol phosphate might arise from the lipid part of the cell membrane, and in which case we will call that teichoic acid as lipoteichoic acid. Remember, G for glycerol phosphate and G for goes inside. So, it is the, even if you forget whether it was glycerol phosphate or ribitol phosphate, remember, G for glycerol phosphate and G for goes inside. So it is the glycerol phosphate teichoic acid which goes, you know, inside, meaning it arises from the inner part of the bacterial the G plus bacterial structure, that is which exact part? The lipid part of the cell membrane. Okay, and what is the significance of this lipoteichoic acid? It was, guys, discovered later on that this lipoteichoic acid has endotoxin like effects, like fever, hypotension, etc., which we have discussed in the discussion on endotoxin. So it has got endotoxin-like activity. So even some gram-positive bacteria also can, you know, when they infect somebody, they can lead on to the production of endotoxic shock-like features by virtue of the presence of lipoteichoic acid in their structure. Okay, so this is about teichoic acids. Now, G minus bacteria, the analogous structures for attaching to the host cells in G minus or gram negative bacteria are fimbriae or pili. Now these are made up of proteins called pilins. Okay, proteins called pilins. So P for proteins, P for pilins. Okay, P for pili, and these pilins, these are highly antigenic. These are highly antigenic. In immunology, we are going to discuss what is a good antigen, what is a not so good antigen. A good antigen or a substance which is said to be highly antigenic is the one which is going to irritate our immune system or wake up our immune system from sleep so that the immune system produces a lot of antibodies against that substance. So when we say pilins are highly antigenic, it means that the immune system is going to produce a lot of antibodies against these pili. Okay, so this is one fact about pili which you need to remember. Then the other thing is classification of pili or fimbriae. Now there are several kinds of classification, but the important one which you need to remember are, you know, mannose sensitive pili or fimbriae and mannose resistant. Okay, so mannose sensitive pili or fimbriae, they attach to mannose sugar on the host cell, whereas mannose resistant pili or fimbriae are the ones which attach to sugars other than mannose. They attach to sugars other than mannose. Alright, so remember these adhesins. Now the next important structure which we need to discuss in bacterial cell anatomy are the flagella. Now flagella are what? These are the organs of
locomotion, okay, in bacteria. Now, these are longer than pili. Now, guys, have a look at this. These are flagella, okay. Dhoni's hair, you know, analogous to flagella. And this is a famous Bollywood movie, Tashan. Did not do that well. But I think the haircut of Akshay Kumar can definitely help us remember about, you know, something about bacteria. Pili. Pili are shorter and straighter than flagella. Okay. Remember this from this picture. So, pili are shorter and straighter. They are shorter and straighter than the flagella. Now, the flagella has three important parts. Basal body, hook, and filament. And they are made up of protein called flagellin. And this has the flagellar antigen, also known as the H antigen. Alright, so far we have, you know, understood two important antigens pertaining to bacteria, the O antigen or the somatic antigen. Remember that I talked about while discussing the outer membrane of gram-negative bacteria where LPS is located. So, outer polysaccharide or somatic antigen is nothing but the outer polysaccharide, which is a part of the endotoxin or LPS. And now we are learning, you know, another second kind of antigen called as the flagellar antigen, okay, or the H antigen. Now, remember guys, flagella can be present in both gram-positive or gram-negative bacteria. So, some gram-positive bacteria are motile because of flagella and some gram-negative bacteria can be motile again because of flagella. Whereas, so H antigen can be present in both G plus and G minus, whereas the O antigen is present only in gram-negative bacteria. Okay, remember that. It is not an obligatory structure for bacteria. So, all bacteria are not motile. Okay. So, it is present in only some bacteria and not all. Now, next important thing which you need to know about flagella is their arrangement. In not just, you know, as straightforward questions as in what kind of arrangement of flagella is seen in so and so bacterium. Apart from these straight and direct questions, in a lot of clinical vignettes in infectious diseases, you could be, you know, told certain clues about the infectious agent in the form of, you know, the flagellar arrangement which was visualized under the microscope, or the kind of motility that was observed in the lab when that sample was sent to the lab. All right. So, as I've been saying, all these facts which we are discussing in general micro, they form the crux or the ABC of, you know, of the ability to solve clinical vignettes also. So, this again is a very good example to emphasize the same fact, the arrangements of flagella in different bacteria. Okay, you need not remember everything, just the most important arrangements which are seen in certain, some of the most important, medically important bacteria. For instance, number one. So, what is this? This is rod or a bacillus. Okay, so this is the bacterium. The shape is rod or bacillus shaped and it has got two poles or two ends. Imagine this pen which I am holding. This is a rod or a bacillus. Okay, so this is a 3D view and I have, what I have drawn is only 2D view you can see over here. So, my point is, there are two poles. This is one pole. This is the second pole. Okay. And from one pole, this hair-like structure arises. This is nothing but flagella. And this kind of arrangement is referred to as unipolar. Uni means one. Polar means pole. Also known as monotrichous arrangement. Monotrichous arrangement. Okay. Mono means one, trichus means what? Trichus actually means hair. Okay, who is a trichologist? A trichologist is a hair specialist, not a flagellar specialist. The point is, just like hair are long and slender, flagella are also long and slender structures. Okay, so this is one kind of arrangement. unipolar or monotrichous arrangement. Now, some important, you know, names of bacteria you should keep in mind regarding this unipolar or monotrichous arrangement. Now, who is this fellow nicely smiling? This is a VIP, very important person. Okay, you can see this, you know, fellow, you know, happily flaunting its VIP status. Okay, have I told you VIP anywhere else? If you have been seeing the videos from the beginning, I have already, you know, mentioned about VIP somewhere else also. This is how you're supposed to read. If you forget something, go back to your notes and see where you have read a similar term. Remember, VIP also, I have told you, in the context of unconventional infectious agents, okay, viroids and prions, okay. So, the same mnemonic we are going to use to remember the examples of bacteria having unipolar or monotrichous arrangement. That is, remember, the examples include VIP. Now, V stands for Vibrio cholerae, I stands for nothing, P stands for Pseudomonas aeruginosa, all right? So, it goes like this, VIP. I is a vowel, ignore it. Remember V and P. And there's a reason why I have chosen red color to write down the names of these bacteria. These are gram-negative bacteria. Okay, gram-negative bacteria. Now, second example, let me take. Again, I'm using red color. So, this is what? This again is a gram-negative bacterium, but it is spiral in shape. Now, this guys is not a spirochete. This is another kind of spiral bacterium. It's a rigid spiral. Spirochetes are flexible spiral bacteria, whereas this fellow is a rigid one. Okay, again, it you can see it has got two poles. This is one pole number one, this is pole number two. Now, it has got, just like the tail of a horse, a bunch of flagella arising from one pole. This arrangement is referred to as lophotrichous arrangement of flagella, and its example is Helicobacter pylori. Okay. So, Helicobacter pylori is what? It is a rigid gram-negative spiral bacterium. Okay? So, remember, lofo is present in lico. This is just a little memorizing tip for all of you. Lofo is present in lico. So, we are through with unipolar. And yeah, one more thing. Remember, unipolar, U for unipolar, U for unique. VIP people are unique. That's how you should recall. U for unipolar or U for unique also. Unique people are nothing but VIP individuals. Okay. So, and the second arrangement is the lophotrichous arrangement. Then we have got the third kind of arrangement. Now, we have got, we have been talking about only one pole of the bacterium. So, the other pole is feeling bad. So, let us provide flagellum to another, to the other pole also. Because flagella are arising from both the poles, this kind of arrangement is referred to as amphitrichous. Okay, amphi means both. Flagella arising from both the poles. Examples include spirillum minus and alkali genes fecalis. Okay, remember A and S. First A stands for amphitrichous, second A stands for alkali genes fecalis, and S stands for spirillum minus. Then the last kind of arrangement which you should remember is this. This again is rot or bacillus. Now, not just the poles, but the flagella are arising from all over the surface of this bacterium. This is referred to as what kind of an arrangement? Peritrichous arrangement. Okay, peritrichous arrangement. Peri means what? It means perimeter. So imagine this pen is a rod or bacillus, and threads or flagella are arising from, you know, all over the surface or the perimeter of the pen. So peritrichous arrangement. Now guys, think of some sports channel which has been, you know, bought by another sports channel, and that sports channel used to be really, really famous. Okay, anything comes to your mind? If any of you are sports freaks, what am I referring to actually? I am referring to ESPN. Okay, ESPN channel. Now, what I want you all to remember from ESPN is perimeter means, you know, all over the surface. And ESPN also was a famous sports channel, you know, being which was watched by, you know, almost all the people. Okay, so that is the link between peritrichous and ESPN, just to help you recall the names of the important examples, where E stands for Escherichia coli, S stands for Salmonella, and P stands for Proteus, N stands for nothing. All right. So guys, all these organisms are, you know, examples of peritrichous arrangement. And there's one more thing common amongst all these three. These belong to the family Enterobacteriaceae. All right. Now, remember, Enterobacteriaceae is a family of what? Gram-negative rods. We are going to discuss it in detail in bacteriology. All right. Now, Enterobacteriaceae has got both motile and non-motile members. Okay. Motile as well as non-motile. Now, it's like, you know, all or none phenomenon. Either the bacteria are non-motile, or if they are motile, they are going to have what? Peritrichous arrangement. So, either no flagella at all, and if at all flagella are present, they are going to decorate the bacterial rod all over the surface. Okay, so that's like all or none phenomenon. Either no flagellum at all, or all over flagella all over the place, all over, you know, the surface of the bacterium. So remember this. Now, pertaining to flagella, we have seen the arrangement. This different kind of flagella could be, you know, mentioned, as I said, in the clinical questions, which are going to be of great, you know, very, very important clues to you in being able to solve these questions. Now, next important clue which could be given to you, or which obviously could be asked as a direct question, is the types of motility, right? Double Q. The types of motility of important bacteria and also some other organisms. Now, the first one is darting or shooting star motility. Darting or shooting star motility. Okay. All of you know what a dart is. Okay. And what is a shooting star? Shooting star, at least I to only have seen in movies only. Okay. So the point is, the dart or the shooting star have, you know, they are so rapidly motile that you cannot trace the motility at all. You cannot trace it. So that is what is meant by darting or shooting star motility. Motility which is very tough to be traced. The bacteria are very rapidly, you know, moving. You can't actually keep a, you know, track of the trajectory of the bacterium. Okay. Now let's have a look at, you know, the darting or shooting star motility. Let us see how the darting or the shooting star motility looks like under the microscope. Now, on the screen, guys, you can see a lot of, you know, small transparent translucent structures which are moving very, very rapidly. You can concentrate on any one part of the screen, top, bottom, left, right, anywhere, just focus and see the bacteria are very rapidly, you know, moving here and there. So this is nothing but the darting or the shooting star motility. Okay. Right, and this darting or shooting star motility is characteristically seen in Vibrio cholerae. In fact, this video which I'm showing over here is that of Vibrio cholerae. All right, so Vibrio cholerae is one example which shows darting or shooting star motility, and the other example you need to remember is Campylobacter jejuni. Okay, Campylobacter jejuni. Remember, VCD, VCD, V for Vibrio cholerae, C for Campylobacter jejuni, and D for darting or shooting star motility. All right. So these are the important examples. Then second, we have got what? Tumbling motility. Tumbling means what? Tumbling means rolling over on one's self. Just like, you know, while making a vegetable roll, we first make chapati and then decorate it or spread out some filling over the chapati, and then we roll it. So tumbling means rolling over on oneself. Now, tumbling motility is characteristically seen in Listeria monocytogenes. Okay, remember, it's a G plus bacterium. Okay, that's why I'm writing its name in blue color. And Listeria monocytogenes, I have mentioned this bacterium previously also as an exceptional case of a gram positive bacterium having endotoxin in its structure. Okay, so tumbling motility is seen in Listeria monocytogenes. Now, another important feature of this kind of motility is that Listeria is motile at 25 degrees Celsius, that is room temperature, whereas it is non-motile at human body temperature, that is 37 degrees Celsius. And this kind of behavior in motility, this kind of change in behavior regarding to motility based on change of temperature is referred to as differential motility. Okay, differential motility. So today we have seen what are differential stains, and now we are learning what is meant by differential motility. All right, now why this happens? This happens because the gene responsible for the expression of flagella, that gene is expressed at room temperature. Okay, so the gene for flagella is expressed at 25 degrees Celsius, whereas the gene is not expressed at human body temperature. Okay, so this is the actual basis behind differential motility. And just in case you forget, a little memorizing tip I would like to tell you over here. Imagine Listeria is present in the surroundings. By the way, Listeria is a saprophyte. It is there in the surroundings. So when it is there in the surroundings, let it be motile, because this guy, Listeria monocytogenes, is on a lookout for some human being whom it would like to attack. And once it enters the body of that human being, it will like to stay in the body and not move anywhere, right? So that it can disturb that individual and cause disease. Okay, so as long as it is there in the environment, let it be motile. Whereas the moment it infects an individual, it becomes non-motile. This is just a memorizing tip for differential motility, which you can keep in mind, right? Then the third kind of motility is gliding motility. Gliding motility. Okay, gliding motility means what? It is very, very similar to the movement of the strikers on carom board while we are playing carom. Okay, so gliding motility means just gliding across the surface. Now this is seen in mycoplasma. Okay, mycoplasma. Now, this motility is also, unique in the sense that mycoplasma do not have flagella. Okay, so this is the only motility. This is the only motility which is not because of flagella. Okay. A lot of theories have been proposed for this motility, but the exact reason is not known. Okay, details we are going to discuss in bacteriology when we discuss mycoplasma. So for now, remember, gliding motility seen in mycoplasma, and it's not because of flagella. And also remember that mycoplasma is the smallest medically important bacterium. Smallest medically important bacterium. How small is it? Just 0.1 to 0.3 microns in its longest dimension. All right. And also remember, mycoplasma are the only bacteria which do not have cell wall. Okay, which do not have cell wall. And also, these are the only bacteria which have sterols in the cell membrane. Okay, cell membrane. So, if God has not given them cell wall, God has compensated for the absence of cell wall by providing mycoplasma with something which is not there in other bacteria. What is that something else? Sterols in the cell membrane. Now, this is really, really important. Okay, so you know why God has made this provision or arrangement for mycoplasma? This I'm going to discuss when I talk about peptidoglycan structure. So far we are through with three motilities. Remember DTG, D for darting, number one, then T for tumbling motility, then thirdly we have got gliding motility. So DTG 1, 2, 3. Now fourthly, the fourth kind of motility which I'm going to mention is stately motility. Stately means what? Sluggish. Okay, slow to move. So these are lazy bacteria, laid back kind of bacteria, which although they are motile, but they are very slowly moving bacteria. Okay, so stately or sluggish motility. Now this is seen in two important genera. Remember B and C, Bacillus and Clostridium. All right, the genera Bacillus and Clostridium. And also I would want all of you to remember BSc or Bachelor of Science, where B stands for Bacillus, S stands for stately, and C stands for Clostridium. Now guys, Bacillus and Clostridium, these are, I've written the names in blue, so these are gram positive bacteria. These are actually gram positive rods or gram positive bacilli. Okay, so remember Bacillus also means the, you know, rod shape of bacterium, plus Bacillus is the name of a specific genus of bacterium. Okay, so we have got Bacillus anthracis, Bacillus cereus, etc. Okay, so remember this. And also Bacillus and Clostridium are unique in the sense that these are spore producers. Okay, spore producers. So over here S also designates what? Spore. So BSC, or you can also write it as BS2C. So S2 means one S is stately motility, the other S is spore producers, and B and C respectively are Bacillus and Clostridium. Okay, so there are medically significant bacteria in both these genera, which we are going to dissect in bacteriology, right? Then the fifth kind of motility is the swarming motility. Swarming motility. Now guys, swarming is not just a kind of motility, it is also a growth pattern. It is also a growth pattern. Okay. Now, swarming means what? Swarm means a group, okay? A group, or, you know, tuft of something, a tuft of a group of animals, okay? Group of people, okay? Moving together, okay? Moving as a unit together, okay? If suppose, you know, I have got water in this bottle, and if I pour this water on the table, you will see what? You will see a film or a layer of water. So, that is how swarming is going to, you know, look like on a culture medium plate. So it is also a growth pattern which we observe on the culture media. Now swarming is seen in what? Now as I said, swarm means group, or, you know, a lot of people together. Okay, so I will give you an analogy to be able to remember the important examples of bacteria which show swarming. Now swarming means, you know, a group, meaning too much. So remember, during the PMT preparation days, what everybody worries about, PCB, physics, chemistry, bio, you know, too much to read. So what I want all of you to remember from this is P for Proteus, C for Clostridium tetani, and B for Bacillus cereus. Okay? So remember, swarm means too much, or, you know, group. So too much to read should remind you of PCB or physics, chemistry, bio. Actually, which should remind you of these the names of these three important bacteria. Proteus is gram negative. And both of these, I already have mentioned, the genus, the genera Bacillus and Clostridium are what? They are gram positive. So these are G plus bacteria. All right. So do not get confused. The stately motility is seen in the genera Bacillus and Clostridium. But these two species, Clostridium tetani and Bacillus cereus, are exceptional in the sense that they show a special kind of motility called as swarming motility. The next kind of motility is seen in spirochetes. Now, spirochetes show different kinds of motility. For instance, remember three different kinds of motilities. The corkscrew motility. Corkscrew is like this. Then, flexion extension motility. If both my hands together, they represent one single spirochete, the spirochete will flex and extend like this. And then we have got translatory motion, also known as spring-like action. Okay, just like when you compress a spring and release it, on releasing the spring, it surpasses its original length. So that is what is called as spring-like action or translatory motion. Remember this as CFT. And I hope you recall the examples of important spirochetes. We saw a cartoon also to remember the same. Remember spiral belt, B for Borrelia, E for nothing, L for Leptospira, T for Treponema. All right. So all these are the important, types of motilities in different bacteria. Now, over here, I would want all of you to remember some important examples of parasites also, which are motile. So, motile parasites, the important examples. Number one, Giardia lamblia, also known as Giardia intestinalis, also known as Giardia duodenalis. Now, this is a protozoan, okay? This is a protozoan and it shows what is referred to as falling leaf motility, okay? So, remember, it's, flat organism. It looks like a leaf, and let us see how exactly the falling leaf motility, appears under the microscope. Now, notice this. At the top of the screen, you can see this flattened leaf-like structure. This is nothing but Giardia lamblia. And as you can see, as Karan Johar shows in his movies, the falling leaves. All right. This is one. I hope you can appreciate it. All right. Now it's going to the left. Now it is at the bottom. All right, guys. So this is the falling leaf motility. Then the second important example is Trichomonas vaginalis. This again is a protozoan, okay, and it looks like an inverted pear, something like this. This is an extremely schematic diagram. Details we are going to read in parasitology. This is the anterior end, this is the posterior end. So anterior part has got three flagella and the posterior part has got one flagella. I just want to convey the message that the anterior part is more motile as compared to the posterior part. So the posterior part will, lag behind in terms of motility as compared to the more motile anterior part. And because of this, the kind of motility which this organism shows is referred to as twitching motility. Twitching motility, also known as jerky motion or jerky motility. All right. Now, let us see how it looks like under the microscope. As you can see over here, these thin structures, you can see they are nothing but flagella. And as you can see, this anterior part is more motile as compared to the posterior part. All right. So, this is one Trichomonas vaginalis. This is second one. This is the third one. This is a very classical example. As you can see, anterior part is running, much faster than the posterior part. Okay. All right. So these are further in the frame. Other organisms, other Trichomonas vaginalis organisms, you know, nicely demonstrating, flaunting their twitching motion. Now, next important thing which you need to know in the context of motility is, motility is seen by what is known as hanging drop preparation. Hanging drop preparation under the light microscope. Okay, under the light microscope. And an indirect method to ascertain whether an organism is motile or not is to look under the electron microscope for the presence of flagella. Okay, remember, the ultrastructural details of any cell can be ascertained very nicely with the help of electron microscope. Okay, so this is the direct method, you know, of seeing motility, the HD preparation. And the indirect method is, indirectly, one can visualize the flagella under the electron microscope. Now, the next important structural aspect of bacteria is what is referred to as glycocalyx. Okay, now what is this? It is not present in all bacteria, but present in only some of them. Now, this is the outermost, this is the outermost part of the bacterial cell envelope. And remember, it is an optional structure. Alright, so it is not present in all bacteria. Now, let us first understand what glycocalyx means and what are the terms related to glycocalyx. Alright, now see over here, guys. What is this? What I have drawn over here? This is a piece of cloth. Okay, suppose you go shopping and you want to, you know, buy this piece of cloth from which you want to, you know, formulate some dress material. Okay. Now, this dress material is analogous to the bacterial glycocalyx. All right. So, I have drawn light pink and dark pink colors over here. Okay. Now, from this cloth, what you can prepare? One is, what this lady is wearing? What is this? She's wearing a muffler. Okay. This muffler is loosely fitted around the neck. Okay. Because it should not suffocate the person also. All right. So, when this glycocalyx is present loosely around the bacteria, we call it as slime. Okay. Slime. Also, remember that glycocalyx, you know, structurally, it is what? It is nothing but polysaccharide. Okay. So, if this polysaccharide is loosely arranged around a certain bacteria, then that loose arrangement of glycocalyx is referred to as slime. All right. On the other hand, if you use that glycocalyx cloth to produce, you know, to form a tightly fitting structure as, you know, seen over here, this cap is, you know, nicely fitting this lady's head, this tight structure is referred to as capsule. Okay, so basically my point is, the polysaccharide which we are referring to as glycocalyx, which is the outermost part of the cell envelope in certain bacteria, if this glycocalyx or polysaccharide is loosely arranged, we call it as slime. Whereas, if it forms a firmly adherent structure around the bacterial cell, then we are going to call it as capsule. Okay. Remember, the word capsule has got cap in it, and nobody would like to buy a loosely fitting cap. The cap should have a perfect fit. It should be firmly adherent, you know, on the top of the head. Okay. So, this keep in mind. And now we are going to understand now we have understood glycocalyx, slime and capsule. So, glycocalyx is the outermost part of the bacterial cell envelope, and this is made up of polysaccharide. So, automatically the capsule and the slime also are made up of polysaccharide only. Okay. So, let me use the short form PS for polysaccharide. Okay. If it is, so it could be the glycocalyx. It could be either slime or capsule. Slime is loosely present around the bacterial cell, whereas capsule is a firmly adherent structure. All right. Now, question is often asked, bacterial capsule is made up of what? Obviously, the answer is going to be polysaccharide. But guys, there are two important exceptions over here. Now, remember, the capsule is made up of PS, that is polysaccharide, except in two important bacteria, that is Bacillus anthracis, which is the causative agent of anthrax. Okay, so it causes the disease anthrax, and the other one is Yersinia pestis, which causes the disease plague. So we have discussed the genus Bacillus as the genus of gram positive organisms. So that is why I have used blue color. This is a G plus bacterium. Yersinia pestis is a G minus bacterium. All right. So these are two important examples of bacteria where the capsule is not made up of polysaccharide. Instead, in these two organisms have got a protein capsule. They have got protein capsule. Okay. Now, over here, I would like to point out some important facts about Bacillus anthracis. That is, it is the largest medically important bacterium. Okay, so we now know the names of the smallest medically bacterium also, which I mentioned before, that is Mycoplasma. And now we also know the name of the largest medically important bacterium, that is Bacillus anthracis. Medically important, of course, means what? Those bacteria which are going to make humans sick. All right, so this is the largest one. Now, the other thing which I would like to point out over here is, see, it is the largest bacterium. All right, so remember, it is so large. And it has got a big ego. It has got such a big ego, this bacterium, that it does not like to move around. So that makes it non-motile. Non-motile. Now, guys, this I'm pointing out because a while ago, while discussing the types of motility, I have mentioned that the genera Bacillus and Clostridium are motile by virtue of stately motility, okay, or sluggish motility. So, Bacillus anthracis is an important exception in the sense that it is the only member of genus Bacillus which is non-motile. So, remember, biggest size, big ego, will not move around, so it is non-motile, all right? Now, next you need to remember the important examples of capsulated organisms, because it could be, of course, asked as not only a direct question, but also, you know, certain infectious disease clinical vignettes could mention in the, you know, in the question whether the organism was having a capsule or not. Okay, as tested in the lab. So you need to, just on that basis, you can rule in or rule out some of the options provided to you in the question. Okay, so examples of capsulated microbes. How you're going to remember them? Remember some creatures. Okay. So, on purpose, I am writing the incorrect spelling of creatures. Some creatures have pretty nice capsules. Okay. Now, deliberately, I have left some space, you know, below some. The reason is some important examples I want you all to remember from this. Remember, one S is Streptococcus pneumoniae, also known as pneumococcus. Then we have got Streptococcus pyogenes. Okay. And then we have got Streptococcus agalactiae. Okay. All these are what? These are G plus gram positive cocci. Okay, so all these are cocci. The name itself has got coccus, and these are gram positive. So I have written the names in blue, then dark blue. Then K stands for what? K stands for a gram negative organism, that is Klebsiella pneumoniae. Klebsiella pneumoniae. Okay. So it is gram negative, G minus bacterium. H stands for Haemophilus influenzae. This again is G negative. Then we have got Pseudomonas aeruginosa. Again G negative, gram negative. N stands for Neisseria meningitidis. This is a gram negative diplococcus. Okay, cocci arranged in pairs. Then now all the examples I have written so far, all these are what? All these are bacteria. These are bacteria. Now the last word in this sentence. Some creatures have pretty nice capsules. The last word, that is the capsules. The C over here stands for what? It doesn't stand for a bacterium. Instead, it stands for a very important fungus. That is Cryptococcus. Okay? Neoformans. Even though its name says coccus, do not think it is a bacterium. It is a fungus. Okay? And it is a yeast. Okay, it is a yeast, or strictly speaking, a true yeast. And there's a reason behind me writing the name in blue, because we, although, you know, do gram stain for bacteria, but there are certain fungi called as yeast and also yeast-like fungi which take up gram stain very well. Okay, in mycology, we are going to discuss that all fungi are gram positive, and if you are suspecting yeast or yeast-like infection in a patient, then we should definitely go for gram stain, because both the yeast, the true yeast, as well as the yeast like fungi, both of them take up gram stain very well and appear nicely blue under the microscope. So this is a gram. Of course, as I said, all fungi are gram positive, so it's also a gram positive. Okay, so this is a true yeast. Okay, so do remember these important, all these important examples. And now I would want all of you to make a nice box, okay, and note down a very important thing. Histoplasma capsulatum, which by the way is a fungus, okay. Histoplasma capsulatum is not capsulated, okay. The name is a misnomer, okay? If somebody's name is Ram, it doesn't necessarily imply that the person is not going to do any wrong deed, okay? So this name is just a misnomer. This fungus, actually, when it was discovered, it was erroneously believed to have a capsule. So it was, the species name was kept as Capsulatum. But later on, it was discovered that there is no capsule present. But still, you know, the name had caught on so much that the name was not changed. Okay, so remember, Histoplasma capsulatum is not capsulated. Okay, so it's a misleading name. Now, next important thing which you need to remember in the context of a capsule is, how can you show the capsule under the microscope? The capsule can be detected by, one, we have already discussed, negative staining, like India ink and nigrosin, which we have discussed while talking on stains. And the second one is Quellung reaction, also known as capsular swelling reaction. Okay, Quellung reaction or capsular swelling reaction. Now, what is Quellung reaction or capsular swelling reaction? Now, if you see carefully over here, suppose we are, suspecting infection by some capsulated organism. Now, let me take the example of pneumococcus. Remember, it is also known as Streptococcus pneumoniae, and I had mentioned this name in the mnemonic on capsulated organisms, right? So guys, it's a diplococcus, and it's responsible for a lot of important diseases like, pneumonia, meningitis, otitis media, etc., etc. And it's very, very important to make a correct diagnosis of this organism, okay? So one method of diagnosis is Suppose there's a patient who is, you know, presenting with the signs and symptoms of meningitis, and the CSF sample is collected, and it comes to my lab, okay? And the patient is an adult and presenting with acute meningitis, and this organism, by the way, is the most common cause of acute meningitis in adults. So I would want to find out whether pneumococcus is the cause in this patient or not. So what I can do is, see, if we see this organism, if we see the CSF sample, you know, under the microscope, and if this organism is actually present in CSF, so the picture will look like this, okay? On focus on the, you know, left part of this picture. So you can see, you might be able to see the, you know, these diplococci with the nice capsule around. And if suppose at this point of time, just on the basis of this observation under the microscope, I can tentatively call these organisms as pneumococci, which are lanceolate shaped diplococci surrounded by a capsule. But how can I be absolutely sure? Okay, I can be absolutely sure if I treat the CSF sample with what is known as anti-serum. Now, anti-serum is nothing but a collection of antibodies, you know, if against the captured antigens of pneumococcus. Okay, so remember, the capsule of this organism has been studied nicely, and all the captured antigens, their structure is known, and because the structure is known, antibodies against those capsules are, you know, available for diagnostic purpose, and these are commercially available in the market in the form of pneumococcal capsular anti-serum. Right, and suppose I have got this anti-serum present in my lab. So what I will do is, I will mix that anti-serum to the CSF sample, and I will see, you know, whether any changes I can see under the microscope or not. If it is actually pneumococcus, then what will happen on addition of anti-serum? The antibodies will go and stick onto the capsule, and the capsule will appear as if it has become swollen up. Okay, so just a schematic diagram. If suppose, see, it's a lanceolate shaped or flame shaped diplococcus. So if these two, you know, triangles represent the pneumococcus, and this circle represents the capsule. So this is the capsule. And when I add the anti-serum, those antibodies, these Y-shaped structures are antibodies. Now, just like, you know, a lock can be opened by a specific key only, similarly, antibodies will go and bind to their specific antigen only, okay? So these antibodies, which are commercially available in the market, they are going to entertain or bind to only the capsular antigens of pneumococcus and no other organism, all right? So when I mix the pneumococcal anti-serum, these antibodies will nicely, you know, bind to the capsule, and under the microscope, the picture will look like what we are seeing, you know, on the right hand side. So this is referred to, the capsule will appear as if it has become swollen up. So this is nothing but a quelling reaction or the capsular swelling reaction. All right. Whereas if after adding the pneumococcal anti-serum, no such change is observed under the microscope, then I can safely say that, okay, pneumococcus is not responsible for the meningitis signs and symptoms in this patient. Okay, there could be another cause. All right. So this is about the capsule. Moving ahead with the next aspect regarding the bacterial cell structure or anatomy, we have got what is known as peptidoglycan. Now guys, I had mentioned this fancy term during the introduction to microorganisms when I was discussing about bacteria. Now I'm gonna dissect this term, peptidoglycan. Peptido means what? Peptido means peptide. And glycan means sugar. Now, peptidoglycan does what? It forms the cell wall of bacteria that we all know. All right. So it's the cell wall, peptidoglycan, is made up of two important structural components, the proteinaceous part or the peptide part and the sugar part. Now, peptide part, which is the prefix in this word peptidoglycan, the prefix is always in lesser amount and the suffix is in more amount. Okay, so the sugar part or the glycan part, it forms the bulk or the weight of the cell wall, whereas the peptide part contributes to the strength of the cell wall. All right.
So I cannot call it the other way around, meaning I cannot call the cell wall of bacteria as glycopeptide. Okay, because glycopeptide would imply that proteinaceous part, meaning the suffix part, is in more amount, and the sugar part, which is the prefix part, is in lesser amount. Okay, so peptidoglycan conveys the meaning that the peptide part is lesser in amount, but it contributes to the strength, where and the glycan part is more in amount, being more in amount, it contributes to the bulk or the weight of the cell wall. Now, the glycan
part of peptidoglycan, that is the sugar part, that's very important. It's made up of alternating units of N-acetyl glucose amine, that is NAGA. N-acetyl glucose amine or NAGA and N-acetyl muramic acid, that is NAMA. N-A-M-A, N-acetyl muramic acid.
If you remember, while introducing the term peptidoglycan to all of you, I had also mentioned certain synonyms for it, that is muramic acid cell wall or murine cell wall or mucopeptide. Now, what is the reason behind these synonyms? The reason is, make a note that NAGA also is present in the fungal cell wall,
all right, whereas NAMA, that is N-acetyl muramic acid, is unique or peculiar to only the bacterial cell wall.
Okay, now let us see how this sugar backbone, which contributes to the bacterial cell wall, looks like. Now, let us see. This colorful drawing tells you what. It shows you certain circles, which I have drawn in light purple or lavender color and dark purple color. All right. Now, the dark purple color represents NAGA, and the lavender or the light purple color represents what? NAMA. So, you can see these two colors are alternating with each other. That is, NAGA is going to alternate with NAMA. So, this is going to form what? These alternating units are going to form the sugar backbone of the peptidoglycan cell wall. And if you notice carefully, from NAMA, which is lavender in color, I have drawn four, dropping down from NAMA, there are four little circles, blue, green, magenta, or pink, and gray. All right. So what are these? These are, this is nothing but the tetrapeptide side chain. Okay. So this is a chain made up of four amino acids. All right. And if you notice carefully, let me zoom it. This is amino acid 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. So NAMA is dropping downwards four amino acids, which I have given four separate colors. Blue is the first one. Green is the second one. Pink or magenta is the third one, and the last one is gray. Now, similarly, from this NAMA, you can see the same four amino acids going upwards like this. So, blue one over here is the first one, green one is the second one, this is the third one, pink one, and the last one is the gray one. Now, I want you all to notice that the third amino acid, that is magenta or pink in color, is connected to the last amino acid over here, which is gray in color, or amino acid number 4, by a bridge. Okay, by a bridge. This is the peptide interbridge. So, we have got a lot of alternating units of NAGA, NAMA, and we have got tetrapeptide side chains emanating from NAMA. And the third peptide, the third amino acid dropping downwards from a NAMA unit, is attached to the last amino acid in the next layer of the sugar backbone with the help of what? This peptide interbridge. All right. So, you can see how extensively cross-linked the bacterial cell wall is. So, this is, guys, the multi-layered three-dimensional structure of the peptidoglycan cell wall. Now, guys, what are the names of those colorful amino acids for which I had drawn those four different colors? Now, let us see. I want you all to look at this video and notice some important thing. Okay, we learn so much from movies also. So what did you notice? What did Aamir Khan say? He said, "I la Juhi Chawla." Now, what I want you all to remember from this is, remember, now this is a magnified view of the, you know, glycan or the sugar backbone, the tetrapeptide chain emanating from Nama. This is one Nama. This is the other Nama. Now, this 1, 2, 3, 4, what are the names of the amino acids? It is Aila, A, I, L and A, okay? So, the blue one is A, the green one is I, the magenta or pink one is L and the grey one is again A. Now, Aila means what? Aila means alanine isoglutamic acid. L is lysine and A is again alanine. Okay, and respectively, these four amino acids, Aila, these are L, D, L, D. L is lever rotatory and D is dextro rotatory. Okay, so L, D, L, D, Aila, A, I, L, A, respectively, alanine, isoglutamic acid or isoglutamate. Then L is again lysine and A is alanine. Now, guys, this is in the context of the gram positive cell wall. This you need to remember. All right. So, we have seen how extensively cross-linked the, peptidoglycan cell wall is. So, the PG cell wall, PG is my own short form for peptidoglycan. Okay. The PG cell wall is highly cross-linked structure. All right, and we can say that it's not multiple molecules, it's a gigantic molecule, so it's a polymer. Okay, we have seen the structure, so it's a gigantic polymeric molecule which is extensively cross-linked with each other. Now, what are the functions of the cell wall? What are the functions? You know, when I ask this question to students, the answer which mostly I get is it contributes to the shape and rigidity of the bacterial cell wall, and that is the most important function. Answer is not wrong, but it is not the most important function. It's true that the cell wall provides shape and rigidity, but that's not the most important function of the cell wall. Rather, the most important function is protection against osmotic burst. Now, what does this mean? Remember, suppose this is a bacterium. Okay, when this bacterium, you know, is present in the human body, mostly the scenario is like this. The interior of the bacterial cell, this is a bacterium. Okay, the interior of the bacterial cell is hyperosmolar, whereas the exterior, the external environment is hypoosmolar. All right. So, the movement of dihydrogen monoxide, that is water, is expected to be where? From outside to inside or inside to outside? So, osmosis will, what is osmosis by the way? It is the movement of the solvent from a low concentration of solute to the high concentration of solute. So, expectedly, the movement of water is going to be from outside to inside. Okay. So, don't you think this bacterium will ultimately become sad and it will, you know, because it will swell up and it will die because of insertion of, it will swell up and it will ultimately die. But does this happen? this does not happen, because if this was the case, then no bacterium would be able to, you know, make life tough for us, because all the bacteria would die like this in the human body. But that, of course, is not the case. What happens in this case? The interior definitely is hyperosmolar, and the movement of water definitely is from outside to inside. But still, the bacterium is not going to die. It will definitely swell up, but because of the extensively cross-linked cell wall, it won't, you know, stretch beyond a particular limit. We have seen how extensively cross-linked the cell wall is, and such an extensively cross-linked structure protects the bacterium against osmotic lysis or osmotic burst. So this is the most important function of the cell wall, okay, protection against osmotic burst. Now guys, we already have discussed that there's one special bacterium, the smallest one, that is Mycoplasma, which does not have a cell wall. Rather, it is the only bacterium which does not have cell wall. Then how Mycoplasma is able to survive and cause disease in humans? Mycoplasma is able to survive because, unlike other bacteria, this is the only bacterium which has got sterols in the cell membrane. Okay, so what God has taken away from Mycoplasma, that is cell wall, God has compensated for the absence of the cell wall by providing Mycoplasma something else. What is that? Sterols in the cell membrane. Okay, so these are the only bacteria having sterols in the cell membrane, which contribute to protection against osmotic burst. Okay, so Mycoplasma this way is able to survive, and the only thing which happens to Mycoplasma by virtue of it not having the cell wall is that it does not have any fixed shape. Okay, so Mycoplasma is said to be what? A pleomorphic bacterium. It is a pleomorphic bacterium. Pleo means many. Morphic means shape or morphology. All right. So that is okay. Even though it doesn't have any fixed shape, that is all right, as long as this bacterium is able to survive. Okay. So I always say this thing that microbiology is not only about ratification or, you know, mugging up stuff. Mugging up you anyways have to do in all the 19 subjects. There's a lot of logic behind microbiology also, guys. Okay, so do remember this important fact pertaining to Mycoplasma and the cell wall. Okay, so this is the most important function, that is protection against osmotic burst. Then what else? The second important function of the bacterial cell wall is provision of shape and rigidity to the bacterial cell. Another thing which you need to remember in the context of cell wall is antibiotics acting on the bacterial cell wall. Now, because we know the structure of bacterial cell wall, antibiotics have been devised which, you know, categorically target the bacterial cell wall. Now, what are these? Remember, PCB, again, physics, chemistry, bio. If you recall, I also have used the same mnemonic, PCB, physics, chemistry, bio, while explaining the concept of swarming. Okay, so remember, over here, PCB implies penicillins, then cephalosporins, bacitracin, okay, and then two more, remember, T and V, that is vancomycin and teicoplanin. All right, so remember, PCB, physics, chemistry, bio, and television. Okay, make a balance between studies, that is PCB, and watching television. Okay, so an appropriate wall or barrier should be there between TV viewing and PCB. So just this is a little memorizing tip for you to be able to remember the antibiotics acting on the bacterial cell wall. Okay, so remember, wall or balance between PCB studying and viewing TV. Now, point to be noted over here is that,
Now, vancomycin and teicoplanin I have written in a separate color, not just for the sake of mnemonic TV, but also because these two belong to a category of antibiotics known as glycopeptide antibiotics. You'll read, about in details about all these categories of antimicrobial agents in pharmacology. Glycopeptide antibiotics include vancomycin and teicoplanin, and these are very big sized molecules. These are gigantic molecules. Now, why am I telling you this? There's a significance behind this fact. By virtue of their big size or gigantic size, these glycopeptide antibiotics, they are effective against only G plus bacteria and not G minus bacteria. Now that we have discussed already the structure of gram-positive and gram-negative, right? We have discussed differences in cell envelope between G-plus and G-minus. We can easily guess the reason. If this is G-plus and this is G-minus, okay? The innermost layer, we all know, surrounding the cytoplasm is the cell membrane or plasma membrane or inner membrane. Now, in case of G-plus, the peptidoglycan layer is very, very, very thick, okay? Which I'm representing in pink color like this. So this is the PG or peptidoglycan. In G minus, on the other hand, we have got what? We have got this outer membrane and we have got a very thin layer of peptidoglycan or PG, which is present in the periplasmic space. Okay, like this, very thin layer. Okay, this is PG or peptidoglycan, very thin layer located in the periplasmic space. Now, guys, because these are gigantic molecules, vancomycin and teicoplanin, and their target is bacterial cell wall, in G plus bacteria, there's a very thick cell wall which is easily accessible to these antibiotics, whereas in case of G minus bacteria, there's a thin layer of PG located in the periplasmic space, which is very difficult to be, reached by these gigantic molecules. So these glycopeptide antibiotics are reserved for the treatment of gram-positive bacterial infections and not gram-negative bacterial infections. So this is the significance of knowing all this. Then something about the cell wall deficient forms. Okay, we have got protoplasts. These are the cell wall deficient forms which arise from G plus bacteria. If you remove the cell wall from gram-positive bacteria, whatever you are left with is, that is referred to as a protoplast. Okay, so P for positive and P for protoplast. So remember, it arises from gram-positive bacteria. Okay, P for positive and P for protoplasts. Then secondly, we have got spheroplasts. Now, these are the cell wall deficient forms which arise from G minus bacteria. Okay. So, if protoplast is arising from gram positive, so the by default spheroplast should be emanating from gram negative bacteria. Okay. Now, out of these two forms, the protoplast and the spheroplast, it is the spheroplasts which can revert back. They can revert back to the cell walled forms because they have some remnants. They have some remnants of the cell wall precursors. All right. On the other hand, in protoplast, there is no cell wall precursor present at all. So once a gram positive bacterium has become a protoplast, the switching back to the cell walled form from protoplast is not possible because there is no raw material in the form of cell wall precursors to recreate the cell wall. Whereas the same is not the case in case of spheroplast. We do have some remnants of the cell wall precursors remaining in spheroplast, which can be used as the building blocks on which the cell wall can be built up. All right. So protoplast, spheroplast, and thirdly, we have got the L forms.
Okay. Now, this terminology L-forms is very controversial and different books have got different theories. I'll keep it very simple for you. Now, remember L-forms as the stable, you know, as the stable cell wall deficient forms. They can survive in nature. Okay. Whereas protoplasts and spheroplasts cannot survive on their own. They have to be maintained in a special environment. Okay. On the other hand, L-forms are the stable ones. They are the stable cell wall deficient forms. And remember, mycoplasma, the smallest bacterium, is an example of a stable L-form. Okay. Example of a stable L form. So guys, this is about the important aspects of peptidoglycan. Now, next important aspect regarding the bacterial cell structure and anatomy is the presence of plasmid in some but not all bacteria. Okay. Now, what is plasmid? Plasmid is nothing but extra chromosomal genetic material present in some bacteria, okay, not all. Now, what do you infer from this sentence? When it is not present in all bacteria, is it essential for life of bacteria? No. So, remember, we know what it is. Then, the second thing is, it is not essential for life of a bacterium. All right. So, we know that a bacterial genome is nothing but a single circular molecule of double-stranded DNA, which we discussed during the, you know, introductory part when I was classifying the different villains or pathogenic microorganisms. All right. Now, some bacteria have got, in addition to the bacterial genome, some extra DNA also, which we call as plasmids. So, remember, plasmid is present in prokaryotes, that is bacteria. Okay, P for plasmid, P for prokaryotes. Now, this plasmid is an autonomous, self-replicating entity, meaning its replication has got nothing to do with the replication of the bacterial chromosome. All right, and it is smaller than the bacterial genome. Again, it is nothing but a piece of DNA, so it is expected to have genes, all right? Remember, the bacterial genome has approximately 3000 genes, whereas plasmid has got 1/10 of the bacterial genes, that is roughly around 300 genes, all right? So, it is autonomous, self-replicating. It is very similar to the bacterial chromosome in the sense that it is also a single circular DNA double-stranded molecule. All right. Now, because it is nothing but DNA or genes, and you know, the DNA will be converted to mRNA and mRNA will be converted to proteins. So, those bacteria which have got these plasmids, they are having these extra, you know, genes, and they are going to produce some extra proteins, which could be hope of, you know, some kind of help to those bacteria. Now, what kind of help is imparted to these bacteria which do possess what is known as plasmid? Remember, the functions of plasmid as follows: PLASMID. Now, first P stands for pilus or pili. Pilus is singular, pili is plural. There are certain plasmids which, you know, carry genes which encodes for pili or pilus. And what is the function of pilus? We already have discussed previously. All right. Then L stands for light, that is UV resistant DNA repair enzymes. Then A stands for antibiotic resistant enzymes. If suppose, for instance, there's a bacterium which has got a plasmid, and that plasmid has got genes which encode for certain enzymes which can inactivate a specific group of antibiotics, let's say aminoglycosides, okay? So, if this bacterium infects a patient and the patient is put on aminoglycosides, then by virtue of this bacterium producing enzymes which degrade aminoglycosides, the patient will not recover from the bacterial infection because aminoglycosides will fail. So, bacterium will have this way an extra edge over the patient. The bacterium will continue to trouble the patient. So, what is the significance of knowing this? If suppose the bacterium is known to produce certain enzymes which can inactivate a set of antibiotics, do not give those antibiotics to the patient, go for some other antibiotics. Okay, then we have got S stands for secreted exotoxins. Okay, exotoxins are an important type of virulence factors which are produced by certain bacteria. There are certain bacteria which produce toxins called as exotoxins. They secrete it outside, and these exotoxins are, they are examples of a kind of weapon possessed by certain bacteria, and these exotoxins are going to damage the host in some way or the other. And how exactly they are going to damage the host, that depends on the type of bacterium and the type of exotoxin which it is producing, the type of host cell it is going to attach to, and we are going to see a lot of examples of the important exotoxins in bacteriology. M stands for metal reductase enzymes. Now, these enzymes are going to, inactivate certain heavy metals like mercury. We all know mercury is an important, constituent of important antiseptics. For instance, mercury is present in merthiolate. All right. So, when mercury is going to be inactivated by these enzymes, then these antiseptics will also fail. So, that is the significance of, knowing about different kinds of plasmids and what all jobs they do by virtue of possessing different genes which encode for all these different proteins. Okay. Then I stands for actually nitrogen fixation enzymes. Okay, and then D stands for degradative enzymes. All right, so this in a nutshell is the important info about plasmids. Extremely important.